Hi everybody, it's Cindy and I'm back to do another update for you. I want to say hello to everybody, all my stitchers and friends, and if you're new to my channel, welcome to my stitching world. I want to thank everybody for the prayers and thoughts on my trip to California with my son. I didn't go with my daughter, I went with my son. We had an amazing time. My ear was fine on the plane, and I powered through that challenge, and I'm forever grateful I did power through it, and I know all those prayers definitely helped me. My stitching is what got me through that flight, that first flight. We did go, it was a work trip, and I do sales, and I've been doing it for 15 years, and I pretty much get a trip almost every year, unless I miss a whole time in work. Back in 2015, I was out of work for 2 months. The top six people went on the trip. I finished number seven, and I was out of work for 2 months. So I love what I do. I love sales. I love talking to people on the phone, and it's just a great place to work, and my son absolutely loved San Diego. We got there. It's nothing like I expected. I don't know what I was expecting. Tennessee was much hotter than San Diego, and their weather is the same pretty much all years, either 60s or 70s. It's not hot. It was cold. And I had one sweatshirt with me. That's because of the plane. I figured I might get cold on the plane. I better bring a sweatshirt. I packed all shorts and t-shirts. I'm like, it was cold. I had one pair of pants that I wore on the plane, and there was one day where it got in the high 70s, and that's the day that, you know, we really hung out on the beach all day. Outside the hotel, the salt air, oh, there's nothing like that. I love that smell, and the ocean is beautiful. It's one of my favorite places. San Diego is extremely crowded. One house on top of them another. Every inch of that place has something on it. There is no free land. There is no yard in your yard if you have a house there. But very pretty. The hotel, the spa was absolutely amazing. It's the best spa I've ever been in. And the food was awesome. And it was so great to see my coworkers there. Especially Angela, one of my best friends in work. And we had an awesome time. And it was good to go with my son, and I'm going to show you my award. I'm going to cover the company I work for because you don't need to know who I work for. And it has my name. It's just a plaque of who I work for. And I do want to thank everybody for those prayers. I definitely was challenged on every level of that trip. And my ear wasn't just the popping I had to worry about. I know everybody thought, oh, her ear must pop. She's really worried. No, and I'm going to make this as brief as I can. I lost everything in September 2015, and I'll explain a little reason why. I sold my home, and I decided I was going to rent a two-bedroom apartment. I had a mountain view. It was awesome. I figured I didn't have to worry about maintenance of a home. And I only lived in that apartment for about 4 months, and that apartment was infested with mold, and that mold nearly killed me. I was in the ER twice. I could not breathe. I thought I was done. Thought I was going home, but I'm so thankful. I found out what it was right away, and the mold affected my left ear. Since then, my ear rings 24 hours a day. 7 days a week, it doesn't go away. And that was the first sign I got, and hopefully at some point it'll be gone. I am 90% better, still recovering a little bit. And how you lose everything is if you bring what you own with you, those mold spores can grow in your new home. And there is no way I was chancing that. I can't explain how painful that experience was, or how physically damaging mold can be to you. It could really kill you, and I know it's killed millions of people, and people just don't even know what it is or how. And traditional medicine would have killed me. On top of the mold, they would have killed me. And I had to go the natural path, and I am, I gotta say, 90% better. Please don't feel bad for me. It's this, everybody gets thrown into the fire at some point. And I powered through that, and I am so grateful for where I am. I'm content. I've never been happier in my life. I'm in a very good place in my life. I'm at peace. And as hard as that experience was, I learned more in the last year and a half than my previous 50 years. It did forever change me as a person. And now I'm going to move on because I don't want to cry on camera. So I do appreciate those prayers. I can't, that carried me through. I know it did. And so did my stitching. And I'm going to tell you briefly about the airport. Okay, so getting on this plane with my health issues, perfume and cologne, I can't even tell you what it does to me. It makes me absolutely sick, especially cologne. And breathing the airplane air, it's recycled air. You could catch anything on the plane if somebody has something. So I bought a very, very good mask. And it's a breathing mask. It's a medical mask. It's called I Can Breathe. It's the best mask on the market. And that really helped me on that trip. I know it did. I know it saved me from getting sick from the smell of cologne. So I did wear this mask. Now, I wore it going into the airport, which I'll never do again. I went through TSA, and that mask I have, it's not a blue medical mask. It's actually tan, but it really covers everything, and it's tight, and nothing can get in. And that mask, I looked like Hannibal Lecter. If you've seen Silence of the Lambs, that was me in female form. I had that mask, and TSA were not kind to me. They saw me with the mask, and I knew I was in for it, and boy, did they do it to me. They put me through the scanner. I just asked to be, you know, please don't, you know, put me through the scanner. They made me go through the scanner anyway, and then they pulled me aside. You step aside. I'm like, ooh, okay, great. And I was nervous about just going through that process anyway, and I had my hands in the air like a criminal, like they made me feel. And the lady had the blue gloves on. Have you ever seen Orange is the New Black? Okay, you know, where the guards have their blue gloves on to examine somebody. I'm like, oh my gosh, she's going to do this to me in the middle of the airport. And I have my hands in the air, and I'm laughing out, but it was not funny at the time it was happening. And she's like, I'm going to, you know, go down your pants and all this in the middle of the airport, people. Like, I'm like, seriously? Okay, but what am I going to do? I'm like, what am I going to do? All right, so they do all that now. They finally get done with me, and I get my stuff. Now, by that time, I was shaking like a leaf. Like, seriously, like, do I fit the profile? Like, I don't know. So it was just horrible for me. And the only way I could push through that is I got settled where I was waiting for my plane, and I pulled out my cross stitch. I'm like, I bought two projects with me, and I knew that just focusing on something else would be good for me. And my son wasn't with me because he was meeting me in Dallas. He lives in a different state. So he took one airport, I took another, and we met in Dallas, Texas to fly to San Diego. And I pulled out my pattern and I just started stitching. I walked on the plane. I was the last person on the plane. I always am anyway. I always wait. I don't understand why people want to rush to get on. But I was the last one on the plane, and of course, the guy, you know, I had the window seat, and you know, I asked the guy, please excuse me, I want to sit down. He goes, no. He saw me with the mask. He didn't, maybe he thought I had something. I was preventing myself from getting something. He was not kind to me, and he had a bottle of cologne on him. Ugh. So it didn't make me sick, though, so that was fine. I mean, I powered through it. He eventually let me sit down. And I just pulled out my stitching and I stitched. And I stitched pretty much that whole flight to Dallas. And then I met my son. And my son, even my son was like, Ma, when are you taking off the mask? And I'm like, I'm not. Not in the airport, not in the plane. And I don't care what I looked like. I just didn't care. I knew I was not going to get sick. My immune system is still a little bit compromised, not much, but There was no way I was chancing, and I didn't care what I looked like. I wasn't going on a date. I was going to San Diego. And we got on the next plane, and I stitched even more. And the first piece I'll show you is I finished that piece on that trip, and I finished it on the way back, the flight on the way back. Now, the flight on the way back, I did not put that mask on until I was through TSA. There was no way I was going through that again, and I'll never do that again. It was just not a good experience. Now, when I got back from San Diego, all right, we're at the airport, you know, they said we're in a hold pattern. What's a hold pattern? They had us flying in a circle for an hour because there was bad weather in Charlotte, North Carolina. We flew from San Diego to Charlotte and then Charlotte back to Tennessee for me and South Carolina for my son. We were in a holding pattern for almost an hour, and they said we were going to hit a lot of turbulence. So I put all my stitching stuff away because, you know, you have a scissor and my little magnetic holder, and, you know, I put it all away. We didn't hit no turbulence. I think I was more irritated. I couldn't stitch. I put my stitching away, and I wasted an hour. I was like, what? Now, normally, you know, when I had gone through it, you know, my sickness and illness, it really affected me. You know, the slightest thing would give me anxiety, and I'm just not that type of person, but this trip tested me on every level to show me, okay, you're so much better. You don't have that anxiety. And then when they said hold pattern, ooh, you know, I didn't even care. I was just like, I wanted a stitch. So I powered through that. We eventually landed, and, I got on my next flight. My son was waiting for his flight back to South Carolina, and I actually got back to Knoxville. The flight from Charlotte to Knoxville is less than an hour. It's a really short flight. So we got back, and I landed. I got my bag right away, and I go to my car, and my car was dead. What? My car is like a fairly new car. I baby that thing. That thing gets garaged. It's in my garage. It's like a baby. I'm like, how is it dead? I'm like, did I leave my lights on? You know, did I do something stupid when I left? No, my lights were not left on. So I couldn't understand how my battery was dead, or was it mechanical? So, you know, I go to the airport security, and they didn't help me. They're just like, call AAA or something. I don't have AAA. I have Honda Care because I have a Honda. So I call Honda Care. Okay. Hour and a half later, I'm standing in the airport. It was raining. And finally, somebody comes to jump my car. The best way I can describe it is Billy Bob pulls up in his 15-year-old beat-up car with a woman in the front of the car, a woman in back of the car. And this is supposed to be my, like, tow truck? What? So the guy gets out. I'm like, please, Lord, let it just be the battery so I can get out of here. Don't let it be dead, because he would have never been able to tow me. So we finally figure out, we pop the hood. He just touched the battery with the jumper and it started. I'm like, thank you, Lord, please, thank you. That was another test, because I waited in that airport for an hour and a half. My son was still in Charlotte when I landed in Knoxville. His plane did not take off again due to delays in the sky there. So we both ended up getting home at midnight. And I had landed like an hour or so before him. But I was so thankful my car got home. And that's my story of my trip. I was just tested. Oh yeah, you're in a hold pattern. We might hit turbulence. Oh great, you know. But it didn't bother me. And even just standing in the airport by myself for an hour and a half didn't bother me. My sister here said, I'll come get you. You know, I'll send John out to get you. I'm like, no. I go, what if I could just jump it? You know, I don't need a ride or anything. And that was the case. I didn't need it. And we had rain from the day I left, from Thursday to Sunday. I think my car got waterlogged and it's babied. I don't know what it was. I haven't had a problem since. I was supposed to check it up, and I've been working every day since I got back, so I haven't had time. I will take it and check the battery, but chances were we had so much rain that a little rain must have got in and just short it. Now, I learned a lesson. When I park at a long place, I'm going to be parking inside the garage and not leaving my car outside in the big lot. I'll be parking in the garage with my hood faced out in case I need to jump again. I mean, You just learn as you go. It was an awesome trip, and that was my trip to San Diego. And thank you so much for those prayers. And I'm gonna move on to the piece that I finished on this flight. This piece has special meaning to me. It will always remind me of San Diego. And this is from the Dress Cross Stitch 2008 ornament issue, and it's called Noel by Prairie Moon. It's on page 86. And I switched the red color on this piece to DMC 347. It is stitched on 28 count natural linen, and I finished it flat. I have stitched this piece before, back in 2008 or 2009, because I went back to see the other piece I had on my blog, and that is called Noel. And it's just beautiful. Anybody who has that Americana room like me, this will be hanging right in there until Christmas when it goes on the tree. And it's just I love this piece. I love the colors. It says Noel. One of my best friends is Noel, and he's just one of my best friends. I love him. I miss him. He's just someone special. And when I look at this, I'll think of him too, other than San Diego. The back, I finished it flat with the scrapbook paper. In the magazine, they finished it into a pillow, but all these curves and indents, it's very hard to finish something like that with these cuts and everything with the pillow. This came out nicer than the last one I did. And I'll insert a picture of that at the end. You could see what the other one looked like that I did years ago. And I missed that piece. I wanted to replace that. And I just finished it with the matching cording, in the piece. And I love it, San Diego. The next piece that I have, oh my gosh, this piece is just so pretty. And it's from the Just Cross Stitch ornament issue 2014. And this is by Ink Circles. I used to have a ton of Ink Circle patterns. I never stitched a piece, but I always wanted to do one. This is called Stained Glass Mistletoe. It's done on 32 count Belfast linen by Picture This Plus on page 61. And people, look. This piece is gorgeous. And it has all the greens in it, and I honestly thought about switching out to blues, but it was stained glass mistletoe. I love stained glass, and I want to get a good piece. And I just finished it to look like a mistletoe with the red berries there, and now I was finishing this piece at 1 a.m. last night. Buckeye, you posted your video. I'm like, oh, Buckeye's on there. Nicole, I had to watch you. And I'm like, I was watching you. I had just finished stitching it. And then I had to pause you and I had to go and finish the piece. Then I came back and finished watching your video last night. I didn't go to bed till 1:30. What was I thinking? But I had to finish the piece. And I did simple white on the back. On a piece like this, I wasn't gonna trim it, but this green, the lighter green, makes it pop. This Belfast linen is so pretty, the brown, it really makes the piece pop. And I'm gonna show you what this piece looked like in the magazine. There it is. And I don't know why it didn't strike me before, but when I was thumbing through some of the magazines to put together a whole bunch of kitted up kits to stitch, I saw this, and I don't know, I don't like how they finished it at all. But I hope if somebody sees my piece, they'll stitch it now, because it is an amazing design. It's beautiful, and I absolutely love how that came out. And once I was looking at it in the magazine, I was looking at how some of the designers finish their pieces, and I just wonder why they don't put more time into finishing the piece. Like I finished it, put a little more time into it, and maybe more people you know, would be more attractive because it's a beautiful, beautiful design. I mean, I absolutely love it. And those are my two pieces. I didn't stitch a whole lot. I've really been working on that garden and I was away. But my sister Cheryl, I sent out that fabric to have made into project bags, and I'm going to show you that. But this was, I want to show you the brown that I stitched that mistletoe on, this linen. It's beautiful, and I wonder, it's from Picture This Plugs, and it's hard to pick up the light marbling in it, but it's a beautiful, beautiful brown color there. Now, I sent out fabric to my sister, as in my previous videos, you could see. And I asked her to make me a couple of projects bags. Well, they're gorgeous. They're perfect because my sister did it and she's an awesome quilter. And I just love her for that. Cheryl, thank you so much. You're so talented and I hope you know that. But look at this. Love it. Strawberry, oh, I want one of these chocolate covered strawberries right now. But she did Velcro open. And on the inside was the other chocolate fabric. Nice and big. And she did a meticulous job. I just love these. And this is the other one. And she put this fabric on the outside. And the strawberries on the inside. People, how beautiful is that? Like, how cool. Now, somebody put me up to a challenge. Why? I don't know. Why'd you do that? And you know who you are. They wanted me to find a... I'm not a big... I don't have the skills my sister Cheryl has at quilting. I could do it, but I haven't done it in years. And I've never sewed with the zipper. Okay, so I went online to find the easiest project bag I can make with the zipper. And literally, this project bag only took 10 minutes, and I will do a couple more, but it was super simple, and I'll share that at some point, but look at this little zipper bag. How cute is that? I put that zipper in, people. Look. No, I didn't double line it. This really only took 10 minutes to make, and I'm all about easy and fast. That's me. And I love it. It's cute. And it came out good. Now, I didn't even have my zipper foot on my machine. I'm like, ah, let me just do it. Let me try this out. I had to, when I'm given a challenge, that's just me. I have to tackle it. All right, thank you. But I wanted to show people that because if I could do this, anybody could do it. Super simple. For my sister, Cheryl. Give me 1 second here. That song is for you. It's been such a long time. I think I should be going. Yeah. The time doesn't wait for me. It keeps on rolling. And don't want to cry, but 1 second. Okay, it takes a lot to break me, and Cheryl, you press through that. You have it inside you. And sorry people, 1 second. You press through that, Cheryl, I'm better. It takes a lot to break this person. I have a thick skin, but my heart goes out to you. And there isn't one day, not one. 1 second. Okay, sorry about that. There isn't one day I don't think about you, and you have it in you. And if I offended somebody with that song, I'm sorry. That's Long Time by Boston, circa 1976. And that's a song that me and her love. Great band, great band. anytime. That's in my top 10 ever. Yeah, they're a rock band. I like every kind of music there is. But I'm not a huge rock person, but Boston is a piece of my soul. And so it is for her, and that song is for her. We love that song. I have that CD, and I'm going to finish on a very high note. When I put that CD in my car, and it's always in my car, I put that song on. Yeah, I'm in my 50s. I'm driving down that road. I got that song cranking to the max in my car, singing, dancing. I had a couple. I stopped at a light, and there was a couple looking at me, and they were cracking up because I am singing that song, and I'm that person in the car doing that. That is me. And you wouldn't think that would be me, but that is me. And I don't care what mood I'm in. If I'm in the worst mood or a bad mood, I could put on that song and I'm fine. It's just one of those songs, and that's in my top 10. It's hard to pick a favorite song, but that's definitely one of them. And I know Cheryl, that's one of yours. So that is for you. I'm going to kick at the end. I'm going to show a video of what I bought on the plane, what I bring with me when I travel to stitch. I'm also going to do an update on the garden, and thank you for everybody who wants to see the update on the garden. And oh my gosh, things are sprouting and growing, and things just look amazing in the garden, and I'm still working on that. And I just want to thank everybody so much for visiting me, and I'm sorry about that crying, but I'm sure you all understand. It takes a lot to break this New Yorker. So I want to wish everybody a great stitching week. It's we're almost towards the weekend, and some free time, and I hope everybody had an awesome week and things are going well. And thank you very much for stopping by. And I know some people leave a comment. Thank you so much. I appreciate those. I love responding to those. If you have any questions, please leave it below. I'll respond. I try and do get back to everybody right away. And I just hope everybody has a great weekend. Until we meet again, happy stitching, everyone. I'm getting ready to fly out tomorrow morning. And I'm going to show you what I bring on with me when I fly. I have my mini metal stand, and I got two magnet rulers. I got two needle minders and two needles on here to hold my pattern in place. I bring my fold-up scissor, my highlighter, and I got two projects kitted up. I got my linen, my pattern, my DMC. In two different bags, and that all fits in my project bag, which then easily fits in my Vera Bradley carry-on bag. I keep it very simple when I travel and fly, and if for some reason they want to confiscate my scissors, this is my fold-up pair that I don't care about, but they cut very good on the plane. I've never had an issue on a plane with sewing and scissors and flying, but you never know these days. And of course, I have my magnifiers in my pocketbook already. I hope that helps somebody if they're flying out, you know, to pack up. And I just keep it very, very simple when I fly. I'm hoping to finish two projects, but I probably know I'll be lucky if I finish one. But we shall see. Thank you so much for watching. Okay, everybody, I'm going to give you an update on how the garden is doing. I was away for a couple days in California, and we did get a lot of rain. As you could see, the first row is the kale. You could see all the kale down that row. The arugula, second row, doing awesome. Swiss chard is the next row, and you could see you got all little blooms there coming up. Over here, you have the coastal star lettuce. And you can see they're starting to sprout. Over here, you have the Tom Thumb lettuce. You can see that has all sprouted up.
In the middle, I could see my marigold and nasturtium's flower. I'm not good at saying that one, but those are both edible flowers, marigolds and nasturtiums. And over here, we have the lettuce blend. You could see all those rows are really sprouted. And I left this one rose bush here. It is beautiful. It has fully bloomed since the couple of days that I left. We got a ton of rain. Every day I was gone, it rained, which was good. Good for the garden. So I got this beautiful rose bush here. Over here, we have the romaine lettuce. And as you can see down the rows, that's all popping up. Right there are two tomato plants. I go to a Friday night dinner group, and this gentleman, Tom, he's probably the same age as my dad. He's awesome. He loves gardening like I do, and he actually grew those from seeds, and those are in my garden, so I'm so thankful for getting those from him. And then over here, we have salad bowl lettuce, and you can see it's all popping up here. Now, this was all grown from seeds, so these are all doing really, really well. I think I only planted these a little over a week ago. And I'm gonna take you over to my other garden. This garden is on the other side of the lettuce garden, and right outside my door from my sunroom, this garden's on the right, the lettuce garden is on the left. Okay, so this row, I did all of my mints. I got pineapple mint first, then chocolate mint, then peppermint, and then I have Kentucky kernel mint in the back. So that's my mint row. Up over here, I do plant inside the holes of the bricks, which is awesome. And down in the first hole, you can see I have my sunflowers already growing. And then right next to that, I have my Italian parsley. This next brick, I planted marigolds. And then in this brick, nasturtiums. I don't know if I'm saying that right. I'm sure somebody will correct me. We're gonna go around to the other side. Now, right down this row, I planted Italian basil and sweet basil. Now you don't see, I just planted that today, so nothing's gonna be coming up yet. In the middle on the right, I did plant some marigolds. I do like mixing in a little bit of flowers in my beds, which is good to keep bugs away and things like that. Now over here, down this row, I have my Greek oregano, and then in back of that I have my hot and spicy oregano, and then in the back I have my thyme. And down this last row, I have my rosemary, then my sage, and then my marjoram. Now, as I go along through the season, I'm growing my cucumbers. Those will go in these holes on the left. That's how I grew my silver cucumbers last year. They grew awesome. We had a ton of them. And I will be adding things as we go along. The middle, I'm just kind of leaving empty for right now. I'll probably plant some dill, maybe a little bit more flowers, but this is really my herb garden over here. Now, right next to my rose bush here, I could see this double bird feeder from my sunroom. Now, I don't have a cat, I don't have a dog, but I'll tell you, I feed dozens of birds every day. I see them at dinner, I see them at breakfast. I get all kinds of birds. Birds I don't even know. I really should get a book. But I get my cardinals, my robins, my mourning doves. I could go on and on about how many I get. But I feed an army of birds. And I buy my 50-pound bags pretty often. These guys eat me out of house and home. I do have one other bird feeder I'll show you, which is hanging right by the sunroom. This bird feeder is right by the sunroom, right by the window here in the corner. And for a while, no birds ate there, but once those smart birds found this feeder, they eat from this one too, and it's really close to the window. So I could see this one really close, the birds up close here. I'm gonna take you around to the front yard. In the front of my house, I have several rose bushes that came with the house, and it's such an awesome gift. This first one, they have all really bloomed. Look at, these are gorgeous, these roses. Look at those. There are tons of them, tons of blooms. They smell awesome. Right next to that, I have another baby one. This is the baby rose bush. And as you can see, it's got some really beautiful flowers also. These are more peach colored, but beautiful. Next to that, this is the same bush in the back, this rose bush. Now I cut this one back really down to nothing during the winter. Look at how big it is already. This thing gets really big. You could see there are a ton of buds on this flower. This will bloom all the way till November. And I'm heading left through the front of my house. I'm trying to get it. I keep pausing it because I don't want to make anybody dizzy, but there's my deer. They left that too. Here's another rose bush. Now this one's doing a lot better this year. You could see pretty color, tons of buds on it in the back. Give me 1 second. This is the next rose bush. These have pink and yellow, but look at how gorgeous these roses are. Look at the buds. And then in back, you got the yellow rose bush. They're kind of together, I guess, when they planted them. On back of that is another yellow rose bush. They all have buds on it, only a tiny baby one sprouted back there. I haven't worked in the front garden at all. I do have to rip some stuff out. I'm gonna bring in some really healthy topsoil. This is definitely a rose bush. You can see the red bud there. I'm trying to give this one a little TLC. It doesn't look like it was doing too good. I'm not quite sure, you know, what they did for their plant, but I'm gonna try. over here, I planted a rose, lavender. This is gonna be lavender in the front. So I'm excited about that. I will be adding all perennial flowers in here, but I'm really just concentrating on the back right now. And then over in the corner here, we have the yellow rose bush. Now a lot of these bloomed, it still has more buds on it. But I definitely have a ton of rose bushes in my yard, which I think are gorgeous. I never grew rose bushes before this came with the house, so I'm definitely blessed to get that. And that is the front garden. I have a lot of work to do out here, but like I said, my concentration is on the back gardens first, and then I'll be working on the front garden. But it's still pretty. I have tons of roses blooming. The house looks pretty out here. And that is my garden tour for today. And on this garden tour, I'm going to leave you with a shot of these beauties. I wish you could smell them because they smell amazing. Look at how pretty the buds are. They always get that really beautiful, colorful mix. So if anybody's a garden lover like me, I hope you enjoyed this little tour. And a lot of people have asked me about the garden and asked that, you know, I did post updates throughout the season, and I will at the end. If you don't like gardens, you could just skip it at the end. I just love my gardens, and anybody who's a garden lover will appreciate how it's going to be growing all year. I get excited like a kid with my garden. And I hope everybody's having a blessed day, and I hope your gardens are doing well.